asking me, is this exciting? It's fantastically exciting.
This is a once-in-a-generation type of discovery in physics or even in science.
I think it was way better than any of us were thinking. We thought we would find something that we might just be able to see, whereas this signal was honkingly loud. It was way better than anything we were ever expecting.
I think it's incredible. I thought that, you know, maybe we could detect something, but everyone kind of said, oh no, it's very unlikely.
So the gravitational waves that LIGO saw came from two colliding black holes about 1.3 billion years ago, so which means they've been traveling through the universe for about a billion years until they reached Earth.
The history of SU's involvement goes back to the earliest days of Syracuse University becoming a research university. The physics department hired several star physicists to create research programs here. One of them was Peter Bergman, who had worked with Einstein on relativity. One of the people who was a student of Peter Bergman's was Josh Goldberg.
We were the first physics department in the United States where Einstein's theory of general relativity was studied.
We can't just move ourselves and make gravitational waves because gravity is so weak. We have to look at very heavy objects moving at nearly light speeds to be able to see any type of gravitational waves. And that's why we look towards astrophysical sources.
Many stars, in fact most stars in the universe, are in binaries, two stars orbiting around each other. So if you imagine those two stars, they evolve, they exhaust their nuclear fuel, they go supernova, they collapse down to compact objects, and you end up with two black holes orbiting around each other. As they orbit around each other, the massive changes they produce in the curvature of spacetime generate gravitational waves that can be detected here on Earth.
LIGO consists of two large installations, one in Hanford, Washington, one in Livingston, Louisiana. They have to be running at the same time for us to be able to believe we've seen a signal.
So this is an L-shaped configuration where laser light is shone down an L-shaped configuration, which we call the arms. And the arms are typically 4 kilometers long. So I like to think of it as soldiers marching in time. So soldiers marching in time coming from the laser, and they get to a mirror, which we call the beam splitter. And this is this mirror that perfectly splits the laser into two. So they continue stepping in time. They get to the end of the arms, they bounce off the end mirrors 4 kilometers away, turn back around and march perfectly back in time back to the beam splitter. But one of the main things about a gravitational wave that's inherent to it is it does cause stretching and squeezing of space-time. So what it will effectively do is if we have an L-shaped configuration where the arms are and a gravitational wave comes down, it can cause one arm to increase in length and another arm to decrease in length. So it's kind of this stretching and squeezing kind of motion. So if the soldiers are marching down these two arms and one arm suddenly gets slightly longer and another arm gets slightly shorter, when they recombine at the beam splitter, when they get back to marching together, they'll be slightly out of step with each other. And this means the gravitational wave has come past.
The kinds of signals that we're looking for involve moving one mirror at the end of that 2.5 mile long arm by an amount that's about 1/1000th of the diameter of a proton.
That precision is about the same as if you would set out to measure the distance to the nearest star down to the width of a human hair.
It's so clear that with only a little bit of filtering, you can hear it in headphones when you play the data back. You can see it in a graph. We were expecting to have to use every statistical and computer trick that we knew to just tease out the barest evidence of something, and the signal just sort of shouted at us.
The discovery of these two binary black holes crashing into each other is really just the beginning of a whole new field of gravitational wave astronomy. And it's going to open up many opportunities for new research, from nuclear astrophysics to strong field gravity, all these exciting areas that capture the imagination of students.
We're just at the beginning here. We know these signals exist now. We can get some information from them. We have no idea what's going to happen next.
I've gained a lot of experience in terms of skills that I can take to grad school from this group.
It's very rare that you get to be a part of something this big that will, you know, very likely be nominated for a Nobel Prize.
This goes back to the textbooks. This is what you learn about as a physics student. You read these things and this is going to rewrite those textbooks. This is going to be the example that says gravity waves exist and this was the moment they were discovered.